How angry are they going to be when they find out that this isn't on Insight?
I'm a bit this far through the video and I realise I should probably put some of the stuff I talk about in the description below, so I'm going to put a link to the Montcook RPG Consent and Gaming Forum as well as the actual book publication they have, and I'll also drop some things in regards to lines and veils and the open door policy.
So, Session Zero. What is a Session Zero? Well, Session Zero is a conversation between the Game Master and the players in a game, be that one-on-one or as a group. A returning group to a returning game master, a new group to a new game master, or a new player to an existing group. Session Zero can be used in two ways. Firstly, it can be used to actually help build people's characters, which is how we're going to talk about it first. It can also be used as and to introduce safety tools, which we'll talk about second. Session Zero for character creation, as I said, works well for a group of returning players to a returning game master, or new players to a new game master, or a new player to an existing ongoing game. As a game master, you'll have read the adventure and you know what's going to come up and you know what's going to work well with the party if it's a new player to an existing game, and you can help guide that particular person into making a choice that's not going to be abrasive with the party. Now, that's not to say you force the person to play a particular role. If someone wants to come in and play a paladin but you already have a paladin, you may try to point them towards fighter. However, if they want to play another form of paladin, in the end that's going to be entirely their choice. It is also a great way to fill them in on the ongoing story right now. When we first introduced Ronan to our Dungeon of the Mad Mage game, we'd just lost a cleric, and Ronan had stated that he was a cleric player before, so he slotted right in there, and he's been a great addition to the game.
I'll put the diamond right in Ururut's mouth.
Nom nom nom!
Then tickle his belly button and cast Revivify.
Okay, please stop.
That being said, if he also wanted to be a warlock or such, he could have done that as well. There was plenty of room and he would still have been an excellent addition to the game. We were able to fill him in very quickly on what was needed and what was going on, as the party hadn't advanced too far. Then when it came to introducing Richard, however, there was a lot more that we had to go through, and Richard took a completely different role than what we'd ever had before. I told Richard what the party had done, what the party was comprised of, and how they were interacting. And he came in, and whilst he has been an almost completely different type of person to the party, he's still a great addition to the party, because as everyone's all gung-ho to do things, he's more cautious. When you're introducing, however, new players to a new game, and to yourself, or existing players to a new game, it always helps to have read the adventure, so that way they know what they're getting themselves into. You're going to give them a gist of the adventure, and also go over their expectations, as well as tell them what to expect. If you're playing Baldur's Gate Descent to Avernus, then they should expect that they'll be going to hell. This campaign centres around demons and devils, so they should expect to be interacting with demons and devils, and they should also be aware that there's a little light dusting of Mad Max in there, as well as murder mystery at the beginning. For all three groups, however, they should also be aware of the type of character that you'll allow in the game. For example, you may have certain race restrictions because they don't work within this particular campaign. If you are playing Descent to Avernus and you want to play a Grung, well, Grung are water reliant, and there's not exactly any water there in Avernus to my knowledge. I for one ban most races with an innate flying speed. If you have a flying speed, it should come from spells or your subclass. If your character is built with it, it then means I have to do an awful lot of work around your character, else the game may not be fun for you, and this is a lot of work that requires a lot of rebalancing. This means that I could wildly throw off the balance of a fight instantly and TPK by accident. For the character creation as well, you also want to make them aware of how you're doing your points. When I done one game, I said we can all roll. When I joined another game, we were told it's either point buy or it's standard array. In regards to managing the expectations of the players, you want to make sure that they're aware what they're in for and what they want from this adventure, as well as what you can give them. You want to find out what they're comfortable with, and you also want to find out what needs to be omitted for their safety's sake. Go over the type of themes that they should be expecting. For example, Descent to Avernus can be very much horror. Tomb of Annihilation is very much explorative. Whereas if you want to use something like Candlekeep Mysteries, then it's going to depend upon whichever one you're running in there, as each one is its own separate one or two shot adventure. So, now we're going to talk about Session Zero as a safety tool. Once again, we're going to use Descent to Avernus as our focal point here. So when I spoke about managing expectations, I spoke about themes and such, and people should be aware of the themes of your particular campaign. Descent to Avernus definitely has a horror theme to it. You're going to hell and you're dealing with demons and devils. Whilst for the most part, quite an awful lot of it can be played down, as Avernus isn't actually that scary. Some of the demons and devils sure do look rather... well, if I woke up to one of them in my room, I'd definitely shit myself. So someone's maybe not too keen on the horror theme, you may have to play it down down a bit, and for Descent to Vernus, the horror isn't very much there. There's small aspects of it in certain places, but apart from that, it's fine. Someone may, however, have issue with the fact that they are dealing with demons and devils, and it may be at that point there you have to tell that particular player that that's a major part of this module. Now that's why before I start any module, what I'll do is I'll fill out the Montcook RPG consent form. I'll fill out how I see the game, how I feel certain things in it are, and how I feel the game will be run. The very first question this form asks is, if this were a film, what rating would it be? Now, I myself give it an NC-17 rating every time. However, I also tell my players, it may not be because of the content, it's because I swear so much. Yes, there may be content in there how I describe it as being a little bit, you know, NC-17, where someone scores a crit on a creature who has one hit point left. They're using a two-handed axe, so they slice them down like cattle as the insides all collapse in and the body folds. Cool visual, very gory. As you go down the list of this form, everything seems to have three little dots. A green, a yellow, and a red. If it's green, you're good with it. It's great, go ahead. If it's red, don't touch it. Don't put it in there. And if it's yellow, you may have to have a conversation with the player about it. When I fill out the form, I fill out with what will be and what could be in it. If it's green, it will be in there. If it's yellow, there is the chance for it to be there. If it's red, I won't touch it. Things like sexual assault, pregnancy, miscarriage, cancer, I don't touch these things in my games because they are far too heavy a topic for the game. However, once I've filled this form out and I send it to the players, I then request them send me one back. Why? If I have six players and I have six consent forms that all look the same, but there's only slight little changes, that means at a glance I can see who's okay with what and tailor it around there. If everyone marks everything else as green, that's good. If there are a few things red, I'll find out what I'll need to omit from the game if it's there. And if there's a few things yellow, we have a discussion. With our next safety tool, lines and veils. Lines and veils do not come from the tabletop RPG community, I will tell you that much right now. The idea is very simple. You will never cross a line. If you draw a line at something as a player or a game master, that's it. It should never come up. It will never come up. On my RPG consent form, the reds are my lines. It'll never come up and I won't bring it up. However, you may draw a line at, say, slavery. If, however, you draw a veil at something, you can be okay with it under certain circumstances or with certain aspects. If the aspect is slavery and it's a line, it never comes up. If you find a book on drow and drow culture and what they're known for, slavery is absent. There may be players who know the drow are notorious slavers, but they ain't in the book. The drow never did that. If it's a veil, however, the player may be okay with slavery being mentioned, but not so much depictions of it. If they come up in a module and their veil was they're okay with it being mentioned but they're not okay with it being seen, you may have to particularly change that scene a little. If, however, it's a line for them, you're going to have to maybe completely omit that whole part. The veil is something you want to have a talk with the player about to find out how far they're willing to go with this particular thing. Another easy to implement safety tool that I implement in my game as it's happening is what's known as the open door policy. This one is great if you play in a virtual tabletop or an IRL game. However, it has some drawbacks in the IRL game. The open door policy is rather simple. If there's something you're not okay with, you can get up and you can leave for a moment and then come back. You don't need to tell the game master why you're leaving. You just need to make them aware that you're leaving for a moment and you'll be back. This is very much open to being abused sometimes on a virtual tabletop by myself and a player. I use it to go to the toilet and the player uses it to answer the door for Uber Eats, but that's okay. We make everyone aware that we will be gone for a moment and we make them aware when we're back. We don't need to tell them why we're going, they just assume we need the toilet or we're going for Uber Eats. Were a player to actually have an issue and say, be right back, I would say, okay. If they were gone for a prolonged period of time, I maybe message them on my phone and Discord and say, are you okay? Is everything alright? And if they told me that there was something wrong, I'd say, okay, what was it? I'd let them know whether or not we're still on that topic, and if we're not, we'd move swiftly on. If we were, we'd wrap it up quick. After the game, we would then maybe have a discussion about it. However, at the moment in time, when the player excuses themselves from the table, we assume they need the toilet. Now, on a virtual tabletop, that's fairly easy when you don't use your webcams. However, when you're sitting around the table, it's easier to notice if someone's maybe not vibing with what's going on, if they feel that this isn't right, and you can see it on their face, and then that person excuses themselves. Everyone knows, or everyone that was paying attention knows, that maybe this person isn't doing okay. However, you have to respect the boundary that they just went to the toilet. There are other safety tools out there that work better for virtual tabletops and ones that work better for real games and real tables. As a game master, it's up to you to research these in whole and find out what ones actually work best for you. Every player is different and every table is different. However, you as the game master have to make the table good for everyone. So, just to quickly summarize everything. For character creation, your Session Zero is absolutely amazing because it allows you to go through the rules of your campaign for the character creation, as well as give necessary players necessary lore for their character to know. It'll also let you fill in any new players to existing campaigns as they're making their character and let them know the type of shenanigans they'll be getting themselves in for. It's a safety tool. It's good to figure out what your players are okay with and are not okay with whilst you have an earnest one-on-one conversation. You can also make them aware of any other safety tools that you have at the table and how to implement them if need be. As I stated earlier, a Session Zero is something I believe every tabletop RPG game should have for numerous reasons. However, safety first. So until then, guys, thanks for watching and I'll see you all very soon. The funniest thing about this video that we're shooting here is I've just been told that we're cancelling a Session Zero tomorrow to pick it up on Friday.